Now, what's cool about this algorithm is it finds the top k elements in no particular order in big theta of n time independent of k. Now, remember, the best that we could do from the previous algorithm is if k is large, we ended up using sorting, which was n log n. This is always big theta of n, or at least expected running time. The worst case can be bad, but there's a way of fixing that as well. So this is pretty remarkable, and you might find this to be quite counterintuitive. For example, if the list has n elements in it, it takes us n log n time to sort it. How could it take us less than that to find the top k if k is equal to n? Well, it's actually, this phrase here is really important, in no particular order. So basically, if you ask me to find the top 100 elements in a list of length 100, I don't have to do anything, right? I can just give you back the original list, even if it's not sorted. I said the top 100 is exactly these elements, you know, this is what you asked for. So that's why this is not actually equivalent to sorting. It can be actually much more efficient than sorting. Now, what happens in the case where we're looking for the top half? Seems a little trickier, right? So in the top half case, we can still do this in linear time, even though sorting the whole list is a natural way to do this, to split the top half from the bottom half, and that takes n log n. So the key step of this algorithm is going to be the following simple subproblem, kind of interesting, maybe even slightly counterintuitive subproblem, and that is finding the rank of a given value in a sorted list. So we're given L, unsorted, and we're given a value V, and we'd like to find out where V would appear if L were sorted. It's not sorted, but if it were sorted, where would this value V appear in the list? Now, just for the simplicity of the discussion for now, let's assume that all the values in the list are distinct. So we're imagining here we've got our list L, and we pick out some value V. It doesn't actually have to be in the list, but let's say it's in the list. And what we want to know is where would V appear in L if L were sorted, say smallest to largest? Now, one way to solve this problem, of course, is sort L and then look for V. But the insight here is that we don't need to do nearly that much work. So how do we do it? So let's look at a concrete example. Here's L. This is an unsorted list of unique numbers. They're all two-digit numbers, just for my own sanity in writing them down. And then this is the sorted list, L. It's the same elements, but I put them in order. And let's consider the number 66, say. So here's 66 in the original list. How can we figure out, just by scanning through L, where 66 is going to end up in this list? Well, what makes it end up there? It's in position what? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's in position 8. So why is it in position 8? Well, it's in position 8 because there are exactly 8 elements in the list that are smaller than 66. Right? Because once it's sorted, those 8 elements are going to be to its left, and that's what's going to put 66 in the 8th position. So we can just go through this list, making note of the elements that are smaller than 66. 31, 45, not 91, yes, 51, not 82, yes, 28, yes, 33, yes, 11, no, no, yes, yes, for a total of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 elements. So that's how we can know where 66 is going to be in the sorted list, even if I don't tell you this sorted list in advance.